I'm Ed Gallagher, President of the American Scandinavian Foundation, and it's my very great pleasure to welcome you to Scandinavia House, Nordic Center in America, for this, the first annual Ambassador Edward E. and Susie Elson Lecture. Tonight's topic is Reflections on the 70th Anniversary of the Rescue of the Jews, and we are honored to have as our speaker the distinguished Danish writer, historian, editor of Politiken, and author of the newly published book on the rescue, Countrymen, Bo Lidegaard. The Elson Lecture was established in 2012 by Ambassador and Mrs. Elson to recognize outstanding achievement in the fields of the arts, literature, education, and public service by Danes or Danish Americans. Ambassador Elson, who is with us this evening, served with distinction as U.S. Ambassador to Denmark from 1993 to 1997 and is still remembered in Copenhagen as one of the most effective and popular American ambassadors ever to serve there. It's particularly appropriate and timely that the first annual Elson Lecture deals with one of the most dramatic achievements of recent Danish history, the 1943 Danish rescue of the Jews. And we are particularly fortunate to have this evening's speaker with us, for he is a distinguished diplomat and a leading historian of the war years in Denmark. Bo Lidegaard is the editor-in-chief of the leading Danish newspaper Politiken and the author of a number of books on modern history. He served as a diplomat in the Danish Foreign Service before joining the office of the Danish Prime Minister as ambassador and permanent undersecretary. He is also a distinguished writer who has published 13 different books, and those include the one that we will be hearing more about this evening. Countrymen, his current book, was just officially published yesterday with a ceremony at the Holocaust Museum in Washington. The publisher is Knopf, and the translation is by Rob Moss, who is with us today. The book has been described as a gripping account of an extraordinary story, never before researched by a historian and told through unpublished diaries and documents of families forced to run for safety and for those who came to their aid. We're very fortunate to hear this story from Bo Lidegaard tonight, and I ask you to join me in welcoming Bo Lidegaard.
The theme of what I'm going to say will basically try to answer the fundamental question that I guess everyone is asking herself or himself when they hear that the great majority of Danish Jews actually managed to escape Nazi persecution in October 43. And the big question is, why? How was it possible? What made it possible? And what was actually the background for this outstanding exception from the history of the Holocaust? And that question has been bugging me for many, many years. And the only answer I have got from the myth is the answer that the Danes acted spontaneously because we just did so. And that, of course, is not a very good explanation. And it is in particular not a good explanation when you consider that the actual escape happened not as a result of an order issued by the Danish government, because at the time Denmark did not have any government. It was not a parole laid out by the press, legal or illegal, because we had no free press. And it was not an operation organized by the resistance, because at the time there was no organized resistance. Rather, we are dealing with not one action, not a coherent operation, but a set of events that happened as a result of the engagement and active involvement of a number of people acting in accordance with each other, but without a prior plan. So this makes it all the more important and all the more fascinating to try and go back and see what actually made this possible. And clearly, the answer is not to be found only in those critical days, but must be found in the months and years preceding those days. So what I did when trying to approach the issue was to go back, both to see what preceded the events, but also to try to capture those days in a very different way compared to what has been done previously. Because mostly when we have been looking back at these events, we have seen them through the eyes of those who escaped and came back to tell their accounts about it. But the point is, for those who came back and told their stories, it was already a given how the story would end. It would end with a rescue. But as events were unfolding, no one had envisaged that what actually happened was even possible. And there was no telling that the end of the story would be the happy end that we all know emerged. So in order to recreate all the uncertainties, all the doubts, all the confusion of those critical days and hours, I've been trying to go back and find sources and accounts that were actually drafted, that were set out and noted down during those critical days. And I have been greatly helped in doing so by obtaining access to diaries of some of those who had to flee, of some of the people who actually lived through these days as victims. And you will see some of them in the pictures. This is actually some of them, but I will comment on some of the pictures as we go along. But you will, these people were some of the very few that during their actual escape took the time and trouble to note what happened. And the book follow their days and the 2 weeks in which they moved from being normal, law-abiding citizens to becoming refugees in their own country. And therefore, the narrative begins with those days in the end of September, when the families that are in the center of the book, two families, two young mothers actually, with small kids, husbands, two twin sisters, when they began to realize that the strategy they had pursued, together with most other Danish Jews, the strategy of normality would not save them. For most of the people in Denmark that were exposed to the Nazi persecution, the idea that society would protect them if they stayed within the framework of normality was very convincing. It was also very tempting, because if you think about it, even if rumors are getting more and more intense that something bad will happen, when is actually the moment when you pack up your things and walk out of your door? And where do you go? What do you bring? Some of the pictures here, you'll see when they roll over, is a list, a little inventory, handwritten inventory. And that is actually the first page of the diaries of Kismakos, the mother whom you will see also on the bicycle. And she's literally sitting in her home north of Copenhagen, beginning to realize that it may not work out just to stay home. And in order to grasp what's going on and in order to prepare her escape, she sits down in her home and make a list what to bring for each of her 2 kids, what to bring for her husband, what to bring for herself. So that's really the beginning. That is a list drawn up on Tuesday, the 28th of September, 70 years ago. And the following day, the next in command on the German legation in Copenhagen called up the leadership in the Social Democratic Party and asked for a meeting. The Social Democratic Party had been governing the country before the war. It had been leading the government during the occupation. But 2 weeks, 3 weeks before, on the 29th of September, of 29th of August, 43, the government had resigned. And it's worth remembering the very particular situation that has left Denmark in under the German occupation. Denmark had, in a situation very different from other occupied countries, decided to accept to continue to, or the Danish government had decided to accept to continue to rule the country under German occupation from April 1940. And that meant that the Danish government remained in office right up until August 33. For 3.5 years of occupation, the Danish government remained in office. The upside of that, and the argument for it to do so, was that Denmark avoided direct Nazi rule. The Nazi rule that was imposed on other countries like Norway and the Netherlands occupied simultaneously with Denmark, the Netherlands a few weeks later. The downside of that construction, of course, was that it entailed a number of concessions given by the Danish government and the Danish parliament to the German occupation power. Concessions that we today find embarrassing. We find it hard to accept that a democratically elected government accept to rule a country that is ultimately occupied by a foreign country. And that is exactly what the Danish ambassador in Washington did not and would not and could not accept, but that is a different story. But the Danish government felt that rather than leaving the country in the hands of the Nazis, it would negotiate with the occupying country, negotiate the concessions that it felt was worth the price of keeping Denmark under its own control. So this meant that until this point in time, no Nazi laws were introduced in Denmark, no Nazi took part in Danish government, no Nazi took place or had a place in the Danish bureaucracy. But on August 29, 43, the Germans demanded concessions, introduction of capital punishment, deportations to Germany, that the government would not accept, and it said no, and the Germans took over power. So the situation in September was a fluid situation where the Germans were in direct control, but the Danish government had left, leaving a big hole in the governance structure of the country and a lot of doubts who were actually in charge. And of course, for the Danish Jews, this was a most uncomfortable situation, and they feared, and rightly so, that now that the Germans had direct power in the country, now they would finally move against the Danish Jews. It was not that they had not tried that before. Actually, Germany had on several occasions during the first 3 years of occupation demanded that Denmark solved the Jewish problem in Denmark. Denmark had, or the Danish government, supported by the Danish king, had consistently refused to cross that line. And it had been a standoff between the German demands to at least begin solving the Jewish problem and the Danish insistence that in Denmark there was no Jewish problem. And there was no legal way to address the problem. The Danish constitution, the government insisted, had no provision for distinguishing between citizens of different origin. There were no legal basis, and therefore we could not move on that issue. And here a strange logic entered into the situation, a logic that was extremely important in the actual rescue, because in all other countries occupied by Germany, there were first innocent steps that were taken, steps that were presented as being unharmful, and normally the first one was, as you will all know, to stamp the identity card of citizens of Jewish origin with a J. What does it matter? Doesn't hurt, but it's helpful to know who are of Jewish origin and who are not. So this first little step was everywhere the first step on the road that led to the ultimate crime. In Denmark, this was exactly the step that was refused, and that meant that all the ensuing steps, the star, the discrimination, and ultimately the deportation, had not occurred in Denmark. So the Jewish citizens in Denmark at this point in time still lived completely normal lives. There were no provisions, no discrimination, no legislation separating them from other citizens in the country, which of course also meant that they felt more secure within society than most that they would have if a process of separation had already been initiated. But now, on this Wednesday, the Germans called the politicians, who were, as you would understand, not really in power anymore, but of course they were there, and they did pick up the phone. It is a very crucial fact that the first suggestion by the Germans was for the German first man, Dr. Werner Best, to meet with the former Prime Minister, Wilhelm Bull. Wilhelm Bull declined that meeting because he feared that Werner Best would insist that he form a new government with Nazi participation. And that was the last thing Wilhelm Bull wanted. But the fact that Best asked for that meeting is for me a very strong indication that one aspect of the myth, as most of you will know it, that one aspect has to be revised. It was not the second in command, Mr. Dukwitsch, who actually betrayed the operation. The operation was betrayed by the very instigator of it, by Werner Best himself. This is Mr. Bull, who didn't take the phone. And we have to go a little deeper into the character of Werner Best. Werner Best was a very high-ranking SS officer. He was an early party member. He was a central figure in building up the Nazi security apparatus in Germany in the 30s. He had been directly involved in events in Poland and France after the German occupation. And he ranked at this point in time number 3 in the SS hierarchy. So he was a man of very bad credentials. He was incidentally also a man who never denounced Nazism for the rest of his life. But he was also a very pragmatic survivor, a cynical opportunist who had a longer vision of how to survive as Hitler's special envoy in Copenhagen. And when he left for Copenhagen, he had an encounter with Hitler himself, and he got two mandates that he were to pursue in Denmark. One, solve the Jewish problem. Two, maintain Denmark as a model protectorate, as the example of how nice it is to be under German occupation if you behave, as an example for other countries of how countries can be turned into puppet states in Europa once the war is over and Germany is ruling all of Europe. So Denmark was also a piece of propaganda, a little element in Hitler's big puzzle and vision for Europe after the end of the war, after he had finally won the war. These two goals in Denmark, the model protectorate and solving the Jewish problem, best realized were not easily reconciled. And he was maneuvering to try to achieve both. And he knew that would be difficult because he already knew from the reactions of the Danes that the reaction in Denmark to an action against the Jews would be very negative. He knew, because he had tried to drum up support for an action, that no part of Danish society, no political party, no one, no organization, no part of the governance structure was willing to contemplate that Denmark had a Jewish problem. Very much to the contrary, this was for everyone a red line that no one contemplated crossing. So it's a very important conclusion in my study that what made best maneuver here was not the reaction after the action. It was the anticipation of that action. It was his knowledge before the action that the reaction would be as it turned out to be. Now, Best didn't foresee the escape. No one foresaw that possibility. But he did know that an action against the Danish Jews would be met with massive resistance and rejection in the Danish population, in the Danish society, and he maneuvered to accommodate that. And moreover, he reported back to Berlin, to his superiors in the Nazi leadership, that this was indeed the situation they would have to face. And this can be traced all the way up to Hitler himself. When the order was issued shortly before, I think the date was 26th of September, von Ribbentrop, the German foreign minister, received the order from Hitler, and as he passed the order on to the German security apparatus, von Ribbentrop quoted Hitler saying, "I endorse the action against the Danish Jews, but do complete it without stirring up too much agony in Denmark." So right up to the top, there was this notion that somehow the action in Denmark had to be executed without really creating too much trouble, in reality, without undermining the model protectorate. So when Werner Best authorized Dubčekovič, his next in command, to warn the Danish politicians, it was actually not a defiance of the order. It was part of the order. I'm not saying that Hitler said he should do so, but it was within the vague, broad framework of what Berlin had demanded. So it was a ambiguity in the very concept of what the Germans wanted in Denmark. And this is also the explanation for the lack of zeal on the German part in the following days. Now, all of that, of course, was not known to the Danish side at the time. So when Hans Hedtoft, the elected leader of the Social Democratic Party, received the warning, he rushed to transmit it to the leaders of the Jewish community in Denmark, and it is illustrative of the state of mind that even at this point, 2 days before the action, the reported reaction from the head of the Jewish community, as Hedtoft was transmitting the warning and explaining that he got it directly from the German legation, the reaction was, "You are lying. It cannot be true. It cannot happen here." But it could. And of course, immediately after, the leaders of the Jewish community began to spread the rumor, and it was just before the Jewish New Year, and it was also spread through the synagogue in Copenhagen. The leaders of the Jewish community also rushed to the foreign ministry, where the state secretaries, who effectively were in control of the country or in semi-control of the country, trying to act as a sort of interim government, where the Danish civil servants, the state secretaries, began to ponder on an impossible dilemma. Should they, being responsible for the country being the closest Denmark had to a government, should they actually now act on their own initiative to arrest the Danish Jews, or should they limit themselves to a protest? They were deeply divided between them. Half of the permanent secretaries, or actually less than half, but the leading ones, the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the permanent secretary in the legal department, they both argued, "We must act. We cannot limit ourselves to a protest that will have no effect." As the permanent secretary put it, "Where this order comes from, they don't listen to our protests. So the only thing we can do if we want to avoid deportation to what we have to assume is cruel death, the only thing we can do is to take the initiative and arrest the Jews ourselves and put them in a camp in Denmark to keep them here and avoid deportation." The other half of the state secretary said, "This is an impossible action. How can we arrest the Jews? What are we accusing them for? What would be the reaction in the population? How will the police react if we issue an order that is clearly both illegal and unconstitutional? How do we know that the Germans will not simply take the Jews we have arrested and deport them to Germany? What are the guarantees? How can we trust them? This is crazy. How can we defend to history if we do such a thing?" And the answer from the permanent secretary in the foreign ministry was, "How can we answer to history if we do not take this responsibility upon our shoulders? How can we explain to history that we sit idle knowing that in 1 day or in 2 days the Germans will round up 6,000 or 7,000 of our countrymen and deport them to Germany? This is a terrible responsibility, but we have to do it." So the state secretaries were basically hung up discussing this dilemma for 3 days, from they got the warning to Friday evening, when finally Mr. Svenningsen rushed down to the foreign ministry and to Dagmar Hus, to the German delegation, and offered to round up the Jews at a Danish initiative. Luckily, it was too late. The action was already undergoing, and the Danish action never came into being. But history would have looked very differently if it had. So it was that close. Meanwhile, the Marcus family, Kiss Marcus and a twin sister, the Hanover family, decided to flee. And on Thursday morning, they followed, Thursday before the Friday, they followed the best lead they had. So they did, as I explained, what is so hard to do. They packed up their suitcases, they picked up their kids, and they just left home. For 2 nights they had been sleeping with the neighbors, and all the neighbors had been active in trying to figure out where to go, and nobody had a clue where to go. So the first who came with some sort of an idea their advice was followed. So the family, it's actually Kiss Marcus standing beside her mother, her father there. Kiss Marcus had heard that in the southern part of the country, on the island of Falster, there was a fisherman who was willing to sail them over. So on that very fragile information, the whole family packed up, left the home, and took the train to Falster. As they arrived, they couldn't find the fisherman. So they walked around in Nykøbing Falster, and without a clue, they couldn't find passage. And as the day passed, they stood there, suitcases, tired, hungry children, and literally without an idea where to go. And then Kiss Marcus remembered that as they slept over with some friends and neighbors 2 days previously, they had met a man who had a brother who had a farm on the nearby island of Lolland. And actually that man with the brother who had passed accidentally had said that if they could be of any assistance, she'd be welcome to phone. So they phoned the farmer. And the farmer was actually hosting a small party at his farm, because it was the day before the 1st of October, the opening of the annual hunting in Denmark. So neighbors and family were gathered at the farm to have dinner and to open the hunt the following day. But as these 8 refugees phoned, they were welcomed in, the farmer evacuated his bedroom, and they were camping there for the night. People who had no relation whatsoever to each other, but who felt that it was necessary to help out, because these people quite obviously had no place to stay and were in trouble. But at the same time, you must imagine that they were also still very doubtful whether all this trouble was actually for any good reason. At this point, no action had been launched. They were still quite ordinary citizens. They had done nothing illegal. They had traveled legally. Of course, with 7,000 people being in approximately the same situation, it was obvious for everyone to see that the Danish Jews were on the run. But so far, they were on the run within a legal framework. So the next day, they proceeded back to Falster. There was another clue with another boat and another fisherman at the far eastern tip of the island of Falster. And the whole family, after much practical agony, ended up there, standing on the beach, outside a big forest on the eastern tip of Falster. And there they stood waiting for the boat that did not turn up. And as the night came, they again stood completely confused. What to do, where to go, what to do with the kids. No food, no water, no nothing. And there is a, to me, extremely moving passage in the diary of not Kiss Marcus, but her sister's husband, her brother-in-law, who was a well-off businessman, a man in his best age, the CEO of a major company, a man used to making decisions, who writes in his diary how they walk up in the forest and they find a vacant summer colony. And they eventually decide to break into it. And for Paul Hanover to actually smash a window, open it, crawl in a place that is not his own, like a criminal, to lodge his family in a cabin in the forest that is not with legal permission, is a barrier he almost cannot transcend. He almost cannot force himself to do it. That is not the way he normally behaves. And he finds it deeply degrading to be acting like a burglar and to break into this cabin. And the next morning, as the family, these children wakes up, the adults have not been to bed. They are desperate, they are tired, they are hungry, they are worn out, and they are also very angry. And Paul Hanover makes a ruling: this is enough of it. Now we go back to Stubekøbing and we get some food at the hotel. After all, no one is hunting us, and whatever will happen, we need food and a hot bath. So they walk and they get hold of a cab and they drive into Stubekøbing, and they go directly into the best hotel in the town, Frey's Hotel in Stubekøbing, Saturday morning, 2nd October. And they order 2 fried eggs each. And as they're sitting there in the restaurant, they hear on the radio that very night the action has been executed. And during that night, big numbers of German police soldiers have been searching Jews all over the capital and all over the country. And that now, as it is proclaimed in the radio, now the threat of the Danish Jews has been removed. Those who have been behind the sabotage have now been eliminated, and Denmark has been cleared of its Jewish problem. This message was so difficult to take in for these people that those of them within this little traveling company, within this very close family, those of them who were actually present in the restaurant overhearing this message in the radio, they promised each other not to pass it on to those who were not. So they didn't actually tell the others before they eventually arrived in Sweden. It's hard to understand today, but I think it's telling for how radically terrible the message was and how difficult it was for people who felt part of society to be seeing themselves and to be labeled enemies of their own society, to be declared outlaws in their own society. The action was aimed to capture 6,000 named Jews. The Gestapo had made a hold up in the Jewish community, had the lists and names, and estimated that there would be between 6,000 and 7,000 Jews. A freighter was anchored, docked in Copenhagen Harbor, ready to take them back with a capacity of 6,000. Special trains were waiting in Jutland. So the whole logistic setup was there for a major deportation to take place immediately after the action in the morning of that very Saturday. At that point in time, the harvest of the action of the night was a little more than 200 people. And as the ship was departing Copenhagen Harbor, it departed with these 207 people of Jewish origin, as well as with the Danish communists that had been arrested by Danish police illegally and unconstitutionally in the summer of 41. And as the ship departed with these 200 Jews and communists, Werner Best made his first report on the action to Berlin. The action, Best reported, had been a tremendous success. Now, from this day, he could report that Denmark was free of its Jews, entjuden. There were no more Jews in Denmark. And in a way, he was right. Some 7,000 Jews had simply vanished into society. No one were left. No one were visible. No one knew where they were. And they were certainly not on the ship, but they were gone. And wasn't that the purpose? And Best declared, and this is important, the action over. Success and over. No more hunting, no more action. It was accomplished. Again, this, of course, the refugees did not know, nor did they know where to go. They were basically hiding with friends and relatives, colleagues, bypassers, especially in the surroundings of Copenhagen. Over that following week, numerous small groups of helpers popped up in virtually every city with a harbor and every township where Jews were hiding. And these small committees did not consist of people who had any prior connection to resistance work. These were the school teacher, the local doctor, the blacksmith, the baker, the grocer, and they basically began to organize how to transport the Jews out to the coastal areas where the big problem waited, because how to come over. And the families down at Frey's Hotel faced exactly the same problem. The hotel manager came to them and said, "You do understand that it's not safe for you to stay here. I will, of course, keep you in the back rooms for as long as you can, but you really must go. You have been sitting in the restaurant all morning. You have been seen. It's too dangerous. You must find a way out." But they could not find a way out, and they could not find a fisherman willing to sail. They all believed that if they tried, they would simply be caught by the German patrols and killed. So eventually, one of the helpers took all the money Paul Hanover had, went down and bought a small cutter, and went back and said to Paul Hanover, "Mr. Hanover, I couldn't find someone to sail you over, but I found a solution. You now have a boat." And Paul Hanover said, "But I have never navigated a boat, and I have absolutely no idea how to do. But what's the right decision? Is that to stay with your family, waiting to be arrested and deported, or to make it a go over the Baltic Ocean, a cold and dark night of October?" And after some contemplation, Paul Hanover decided to give it a try. He could not just stay idle, so he said to his wife, "We will go. There is no other solution." And if it hadn't been for the diary of their son, who was 14, we would not know the response of the mother, which basically was, then I'd rather go to Germany. So she refused to sail with her husband. She trusted him a great deal, but not to that extent. So they didn't go. But later that afternoon, other helpers came back and had organized transport. And late that evening, the family went with a boat from a nearby landing place, together with other refugees. And for the whole night, between Saturday and Sunday, they were sailing towards Sweden, constantly under the impression that they were hunted by the German patrols. And every time they saw another vessel, they were absolutely convinced that that was the German patrol. And they were scared, they were sick, they were utterly miserable, and at the end of the night, they were also lost, because the skipper, who had no prior experience with that kind of transportation, had simply lost his way, and at a certain point in time, they were seriously fearing that they were landing on the German coast before eventually, early in the morning of Sunday, they arrived in Ystad, the southern port of Sweden, where they were greeted welcome, and as other refugees, found a home for the rest of the war. Immediately upon the news of the action in the night, publicly declared that Sweden was ready to receive all Danish refugees in Sweden. Now, still at this point, no one conceived of the possibility that that might entail not a couple of hundred of refugees, but 7,000 refugees. Up until this point, some 200 Danes had been fleeing Denmark illegally to Sweden in the course of 3 years. Now, in the course of 2 weeks, 7,000 people made the transfer. It was a huge logistic operation. Thousands of people were involved. And we have extremely few confirmed cases where anyone denounced those who were on the run. To the contrary, we have hundreds, if not thousands, of credible and first-hand accounts of a consistent reaction in the Danish public to actually assist those who were on the escape. It is very clear from the diaries I have seen that the impression of both those who were fleeing and those who helped, the impression was that the Gestapo was after them, that the patrols were for real, and they were risking their lives. We now know that actually Best did not pursue them, and that the Gestapo and the Wehrmacht, the German soldiers, were almost all of them completely passive. There were zealots that went after them, and there were this big strategy in Kidelai, but that were the exceptions. The general rule was that nobody did anything to stop the refugees. And when it was basically over, towards the end of October, the German counselor in Malmö, just across from Copenhagen, at the coast of Sweden, wrote a telegram back to Auswärtiges Amt, back to the German Foreign Ministry. And the counselor, the German diplomat, wrote back. Over the last weeks, a steady influx of refugees from Denmark has been landing on the Swedish coast. This has been obvious and visible. Swedish press has reported widely and in detail about the escape. And according to credible reports in Swedish press, some 7,000 Danish Jews have now escaped into Sweden. And I cannot tell that anyone has tried to stop them. I don't know whether there'll be any Jews left in Denmark at this point in time, but I can inform you that 7,000 Danish Jews are now in Sweden. And the Swedish press is convinced that this could not happen unless German authorities in Denmark turned the blind eye to it. That was not a pleasant report into Auswärtiges Amt, and they really didn't know what to do with it. So they handed it over carefully to the security authorities under the auspices of the notorious Adolf Eichmann. And Eichmann got really upset, and he asked the foreign ministry to ask Best back to Berlin for consultations. And when you see that order, you think that, or you might think that Best, after all, had overplayed his cards, and that now he was in for a new posting to the East Front. But curiously, that is not what happens. Actually, a couple of days later, Eichmann himself traveled to Copenhagen to see things there for himself. And as he arrived in Copenhagen, this is the landing place from where they left, the Marcus family. As they landed in Copenhagen, he had a meeting with Best. And out of that meeting came three crucial decisions that were given as promises to the Danish authorities, to the state secretaries. One, perhaps the most important, Eichmann confirmed that none of the Danish prisoners that had been deported to Theresienstadt, which was a transit camp from where thousands, 10,000 of Jews were sent on to the death camps. None of the, at this point in time, 450 Danish Jews would be sent further on, as Eichmann put it. None of the Danish Jews would be sent further on. Two, Danish Red Cross would be granted access to visit Theresienstadt and the Danish Jews. And third, also extremely importantly, Danish Red Cross would, in due course, have the possibility of sending parcels with foodstuffs and other necessities to the Danish prisoners. And these three promises, no further deportation, the visit by Red Cross, and food parcels, saved the life of almost all the Danish prisoners in Theresienstadt. Germany stood by those promises. They were never sent to the death camps. This is very hard to understand. And the only explanation, and I'm coming back to where I began, is that Denmark was the only country where the execution of the Holocaust came at a price to the Nazi leadership. They knew that they had to choose between continued, a degree of continued cooperation or an effective deportation of the Danish Jews. And as they faced this choice, they actually had a pragmatic, cynical priority that they would rather continue the Model Protectorat than they would deport the Danish Jews. So this was a result of Denmark forcing a choice upon the Nazi leadership, and the fact that here, or in Denmark, there was no support for the action, and there was so little support that it was clear that if Germany insisted, it would come at a price. A price they chose, in this case, in October 43, not to pay. So, this is in a very short form the history. This is now 70 years ago, but it does tell us a very important history of what society can do if it's strong enough and if it has its values right and is willing to act upon it. Thank you.